Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Orson Welles. It is my pleasure to introduce our director, Mr. Greg Oppenheimer.
Welcome to Online Radio Theater. I have to tell you, The Lives of Harry Lime is my all-time favorite radio program, and I just can't wait to bring it to you. So if everybody's ready to begin, that's exactly what we'll do. In 3, 2, 1.
Presenting Orson Welles as the third man. The Lives of Harry Lime, the fabulous stories of the immortal character originally created in the motion picture, The Third Man, with zither music by Anton Karas.
That was the shot that killed Harry Lime. He died in a sewer beneath Vienna, as those of you know who saw the movie The Third Man. Yes, that was the end of Harry Lime. But it was not the beginning. Harry Lime had many lives, and I can recount all of them. How do I know? It's very simple. Because my name is Harry Lime. Don't get me wrong. I love Budapest. From Budapest come goulashes and chardashes. Chardashes being something you dance and goulash being something you eat. If you go for all that paprika, me, I love it. So, when I got that telegram, I took the first train to Hungary. Maybe I'd better tell you about the telegram first. Dear Mr. Lime, it said, my bank is going to be robbed and I need your help. It was signed Fekete, evidently a man's name, nobody I knew. I knew all about bank robberies, however, and was dying to help. Besides, as I say, I love paprika. So I started packing right away.
Are you safe from BO on all 13 areas of the skin?
Be Lifebuoy clean on all 13.
Be Lifebuoy clean on all 13.
I'm happy and I'm singing the Lifebuoy song.
Remember, you can get BO on not just one, but 13 skin areas. The cleaner you get these 13 areas, the safer you are. Lifebuoy Health Soap deodorizes all these 13 skin areas. Stops BO before it begins. Stops BO up to 48 hours. Doctors prove Lifebuoy with a purifying ingredient actually gets skin cleaner than any other leading soap. You'll love Lifebuoy's rich coconut oil lather, its fresh, clean scent. Wonderful for your complexion. Don't trust ordinary soaps to stop BO. Use Lifebuoy every day. Get the longer-lasting, economical, bath-size Lifebuoy right away.
Be Lifebuoy clean on all 13.
Be Lifebuoy clean on all 13.
I'm happy and I'm singing the Lifebuoy song.
And now, Orson Welles as Harry Lime, the third man, continues with today's story, Too Many Crooks.
Before calling at the bank, I stopped in at a cute little flower shop I happened to notice across the way.
Good morning. Would you give me something for my buttonhole? Why, Lily. Lily, what are you doing here?
We have some very nice pink gardenias.
Oh, come on, Lily. Don't tell me you don't remember me. And how are all the Corellis?
The who?
Now, don't give me that, Lily.
My name is Lulu.
Well, it used to be Lily, and you used to be a blonde, and the Corellis, as you know perfectly well, because you used to work with them, are the best bank robbers in Central Europe. Well, what about it, honey?
Here is your gardenia, Harry. Now get out of here.
Okay, honey, okay. No need to get in a hassle.
I am telling you, Harry, get out.
I never was one to argue, so I took my gardenia across the street and wore it into the bank.
Mr. Fegarty will see Mr. Harry Lime.
You can go in now, Monsieur Lime.
Thank you.
Mr. Fegarty will see you.
Yes, that's what I gathered.
This way, please, and...
Thank you.
Monsieur Lime?
Yes?
Will you please extinguish your cigarette? Monsieur Fegarty does not approve of smoking.
Thanks. I'll bear that in mind.
Monsieur Lime.
Come in, and shut the door. There's a draft.
Do you mind if I sit down, Mr. Fegarty? Or is there a rule against that?
Sit down. You are a very impertinent young man. But I don't mind that. I am an impertinent old man. We ought to get along together very nicely.
What's your proposition, Mr. Fegarty?
What do you mean?
Just what I said. What's your proposition?
Listen to me, Lime. I don't make propositions. I consider them.
Have it your own way, Fegarty, but I'm a big boy now, and I'm not so easily impressed.
What do you mean, impressed?
Oh, this big desk double secretary, Mr. Fegarty, will see you now. Mr. Fegarty doesn't approve of smoking. Busy executive hoopla may go down very well with the bumpkins who give you their money to invest, but it doesn't mean a thing to me. You sent for me, didn't you? I crossed 3 national borders to get here and lost a lot of time, so don't ask me what's my proposition. What's yours, Mr. Fegarty?
Very good indeed. You're just the man I hoped you were. Have a cigar.
Wouldn't that be breaking the rules?
I make the rules, Mr. Lime, and I don't like cheap tobacco smoke. Nor do I enjoy being forced to distribute these very costly, custom-made Havanas to every, what is it you call them, bumpkin, who comes into my office. I think you'll enjoy these.
Thanks.
Light?
Thanks.
Now that we're a little more at ease, suppose you tell me something about yourself.
Why?
What do you mean, why?
I wish you'd stop asking me what I mean by everything I say, Fegarty. I said why, and I meant why. You put private detectives on my trail. You found me. You made me a very substantial down payment on services to be rendered. And now, when I get here, you want me to tell you something about myself. That's just plain silly, old man. It's obvious that if you went to all that trouble and expense to get me here, you knew about me already. I'm the one to ask the questions, not you.
Better and better, Mr. Lyon. If you were just a little less notorious as a crook, I'd offer you a vice presidency in my bank.
I forgive the insult, Mr. Fegarty.
What do you mean, insult?
There you go, asking me what I mean again. I meant insult.
Now, don't you get pompous with me, Lyon. You are a crook, a world-famous one. You don't want to deny that.
What I don't want is very simple, Mr. Fegarty. I don't want to be a vice president of your bank.
Oh. Oh, I follow you now. Don't worry, Lime. I promised you $20,000.
That's right.
Or its equivalent in Hungarian pengos.
Now, wait a minute.
And you'll get it without having to serve as an officer of this bank.
Hey, you promised me $20,000, old man. There weren't any gimmicks in the agreement about the joke money you folks pass off on each other locally. I know. I carry my own microscope for reading the fine type.
Very well. $20,000 it is. Don't you want to know what it is I want you to do for it?
Mr. Fegarty, you keep making me repeat myself. I told you before that I'm a big boy now. If you're giving me $20,000, I can relax, not worry about asking you silly questions. You're going to get around eventually to telling me what you expect me to do for it.
Did you ever hear of a bank giving a reward?
Yes, but only after a bank robbery.
Exactly. Exactly. Only after a bank has been robbed. I'm reversing the procedure, Lime. I'm giving the reward first.
So that's the little caper, is it? You want me to rob your bank for you?
No, not at all. A reward is usually given for apprehending the thieves who have robbed the bank. What I want you to do, Harry, is... May I call you Harry?
Certainly, old man. Call me Harry if it gives you any fun.
Well, Harry, what I want you to do is apprehend the robbers before the robbery is committed. Very clever, don't you think so? Have another cigar.
In my business, I may get in the way of an awful lot of screwy deals, but I can tell you that never in a long career have I been offered in complete seriousness a loopier proposition than Mr. Fekete's. It seems the key to the whole affair was Mr. Fekete's junior officer in the bank, a certain Mr. Fodor.
Ladislav Fodor is the full name, Harry.
Uh-huh.
He's one of our vice presidents.
I see.
And I tell you this right now, the man is an unprincipled criminal.
Oh?
Come here and I'll show him to you. Come this way. You can see him through the glass panel.
Ah, yes.
There he is. Second desk to the right.
Oh, that one.
With all those silly hairs pasted over his bald head. That's the man.
He doesn't look very dangerous to me.
Fodor? Dangerous? He has the brain of a backward bird and the charm of a worm. Now that I look back on it, I can't imagine how I ever persuaded myself to be jealous of him.
Jealous? I don't follow you, old man.
If I have a fault, Harry, it is this. I do tend to be jealous. Lulu often chides me about it. I have promised to curb the instinct, but then it is a part of my character.
Lulu? You mean the girl in the flower shop across the way? That Lulu?
She is the only Lulu I know, Mr. Lime. How does it happen that you are acquainted with her?
You see this gardenia?
I see it, yes.
Lulu sold it to me, overcharged me, scandalously, as a matter of fact.
Well, Lulu is a working girl. She must live. How does it happen you know her?
What makes you think I do?
You know her name?
Oh, one of the other customers called her that while I was still in the shop. As it happens, it was this little fellow you just pointed out to me over there, the vice president, Fodor.
Third vice president.
I hate to keep harping on these commercial matters, Fekete, old man, but just how does my $20,000 reward come into the picture?
Let us retire to my inner office, Harry, and I will tell you. Come.
Okay, old man.
Sit down, please, Harry. Have another cigar.
My pockets are bulging with cigars now, old man. Let's concentrate on the 20,000,
Certainly, certainly. Oh, Miss Carver. Miss Carver.
Yes, Mr. Fekete?
No matter who calls, don't disturb me. Not on any account. I'm having an important conference.
Yes, Mr. Fekete.
Jealousy, Harry. Jealousy is a terrible thing.
Yes, yes, it certainly is. Now, about this reward.
Jealousy is the green-eyed monster who doth mock the meat it feeds on. That's how the poet Shakespeare expressed it, Harry.
Yeah, the poet Shakespeare said a mouthful. And now, if you could...
But still, if it had not been for jealousy, I would not have followed this Fodor into Lulu's shop. And if I hadn't done that, I would never have discovered the digging.
Digging? What digging?
What would you say, Harry, if I were to tell you that running under the street from Lulu's flower shop to the bank, there is a tunnel.
A tunnel?
What would you say if I told you that, huh?
I'd say, well, well, what do you know? That's what I'd say.
That's what I said when I found out about it. And that's why I say now that I must never forget to be grateful to jealousy, particularly since I've discovered that there's nothing between Lulu and Fodor. Nothing serious, that is.
And you know what I'd say to that?
No.
A couple of rude words.
Yes, but why?
Why? You find them scrambling away together like a couple of chubby moles digging away in the general direction of your bank vault, and you say there's nothing serious between them?
There isn't. I'm sure of that. I have Lulu's word. And besides, what would she possibly see in a fat little nonentity like Fodor? No, the only one who thinks it's serious is Fodor. But that's the whole point. Fodor is a dupe, a mere cat's paw in the conspiracy.
Oh, yes? And who's the mastermind?
I am.
Oh. And what does Fodor think about that?
He languishes in ignorance. He knows nothing. And to think that he aspires, he dares to aspire, to my position in the bank.
And how does Lulu fit in?
I must tell you that Lulu has given me reason to hope that she will someday make me the happiest man in the world.
And how will she do that? By giving up Fodor or sending you a big bouquet of roses? Let's get down to cases, old man. Wedding bells can ring out from Buda to Pest and back again, but I won't be there to throw any rice unless I get paid. What is it exactly you want from me? Lessons on how to help Fodor and Lulu rob your bank?
Fodor is going to do the robbing. And besides, it isn't my bank. I'm only a salaried officer.
Then Fodor gives you the money to give to Lulu, is that it?
Certainly not. Certainly not. That would be silly.
Yeah, that's just what I was thinking.
No. Every day, Fodor is supposed to take the paper money from the various cages and place it in the vault.
Yes.
This is his responsibility.
Yes.
Tonight, however, he will not do this. He will leave the money outside the vault, hidden in a large filing cabinet.
Oh, yes?
The entire plan has been carefully worked out, I can assure you.
All I can say is this Fodor of yours is a very cooperative type of cat's paw.
Don't call him this Fodor of yours. He isn't. He's no Fodor of mine.
Have it your way, old man. What comes next? You, I suppose, You come a half hour later with a dark lantern and a gunny sack. You wrap up the money, join Lulu, who's been waiting for you across the street in the flower shop, and the two of you, hand in hand, move off down the road into the sunrise and also into the very choicest Hungarian huskow,
What is a huskow?
A jail or prison, a place of forcible incarceration, a lockup for bad little bank robbers.
Not at all. It is Fodor who goes to prison.
Oh, yes? And how do you work that?
That is one of the things I want you to arrange.
Oh, I see. I'm going to have to earn that $20,000. I think we'll start by having it deposited in my name and in somebody else's bank, old man.
Why now? And why another bank?
Well, every bank in Budapest isn't going to be robbed tonight, so I think I'd prefer one of the others. And I'll take it now, because I know you wouldn't want me to go to the police with what is, after all, a fairly sordid little story.
Go to the police? But that's blackmail.
Oh, watch your language, old man. Blackmail's a nasty word, you know. All I want is protection for my poor little $20,000. I'll give you service for it, too. But I want to be absolutely positive that you're ready to meet your payroll.
Very well. You'll have your money, but you will help me.
I'm going to need a few more solid facts, old man.
Well, it all began with this insane jealousy of mine for Fodor.
Oh, yeah?
I took to following him. He used to go into Lulu's flower shop at night, long after it was closed. And one time he left the shutters unfastened, and I went in. There were no lights in the shop itself, but I could hear voices from the basement below. I opened the trap door very carefully so as not to be heard. And what do you think I saw?
You saw Lulu Fodor and three men all hard at work digging a tunnel.
Yes, how did you know?
I didn't, I guessed. After all, you told me there was a tunnel.
But the three men, how did you know about them?
Still guessing. It's pretty obvious that Mr. Fodor and Lulu couldn't dig much of a hole without getting some help. Tell me this. It was Lulu who persuaded you to call me in on this deal, wasn't it?
How did you know that?
Still just guessing, old man, just guessing. Now let me guess on for a minute and stop me when I'm wrong. When you saw what Lulu and Fodor were doing, you went home and brooded for a while, and then, a few days afterward, you confronted her.
It was the next day.
Oh, okay, it was the next day. Lulu admitted she was planning to rob the bank, but said she was just using Fodor, and you were the only one she really cared about, and if you join the party, it's you she'd run off with, leaving Mr. Fodor holding the bag. An empty bag. How am I doing?
You are a clever man.
Sure I am. That's why Lulu had you send for me.
You see, the idea is that Fodor will hide the money outside the vault and leave. Then, according to the arrangement, as he understands it, Lulu will come through the tunnel at night with her helpers and take the money back under the street through the tunnel.
Who did she tell Fodor these helpers were?
She said one of them is her brother, and the other two are cousins.
And what did she tell you?
That's what she told me. Why?
Nothing. Nothing, old man. Nothing at all. Just give me one more guess.
Go ahead.
After Fodor leaves the money, what you do is crawl back through the tunnel with a sack of currency clenched in your teeth. But no, that wouldn't make any sense, would it? You'd run into a couple of brothers crawling in the opposite direction.
I'm not to have anything to do with the tunnel.
Oh.
You see, Fodor leaves the money out just before closing time. That way, he's implicated and we have a scapegoat. So there's nothing to stop me from letting myself in with my key at night and walking away with the money. Who could suspect me? It's a perfect crime, Harry. Wouldn't you say so?
Yes, yes, it's quite a crime if you look at it in one way. Ah, but tell me about the brothers. What are they supposed to think about all this?
Oh, they don't know anything about it. Lulu hasn't told them.
But the news will reach them eventually. And what then?
They must be implicated somehow, along with Fodor. But I must be protected. And Lulu, that's what you're here for, Harry. Have another cigar.
Orson Welles returns in just a moment as the third man.
Good gracious, I've nothing for the Johnsons yet.
What can I get this late for Jim's boss?
Keep calm, folks. It's not too late to buy the gifts that will make a big hit, do you proud, and look more expensive than they are. Elgin American Gifts for men and women. Exquisite compacts, cigarette cases, dresser sets, luxurious simulated pearls, sensational lighter cases, magic action lighters, an almost endless choice of the most wanted gifts, all at real value prices. Gifts with the world's finest designing and craftsmanship. The prestige of the leading name in its field. The thrill of saying, it's an Elgin American. So make your last-minute Christmas shopping a big success. Tomorrow, buy the first in fashion, first in value, gifts of them all. Elgin American Gifts.
And now, Orson Welles, as the third man, continues with today's story, Too Many Crooks.
Naturally, the first thing I did after making my farewells to Mr. Fecherty was to go across the street and pay a call on Lulu.
Harry.
Yes?
Listen to me carefully.
I'm listening, honey.
There's a little cafe on the hill above the old city. You know the place? There's a gold rooster on the roof.
Well, what about it?
Go there and wait for me. You never can tell when Fodor or Fecherty will be bursting in here. They keep dropping across the street to check up on each other and buy geraniums. Go to the cafe. I will be with you as soon as I can close up.
And what about the boys below?
What do you mean?
The construction crew. The Corellis.
Fecherty told you about the Corellis?
I would have found out anyway, Lily.
Lulu?
Oh, okay, what happens to them if you shut up the store? Is there a way out?
No, but they will not be finished work before I am back. Besides, but they don't know what hurts them.
Lily, or rather, Lulu. It looks to me as though just about everybody around here is due to be hurt by what they don't know. I found the gold rooster and sat down on the terrace of the restaurant to wait for Mr. Fecherty's fiancée. Over a glass of Tokai, I tried to add up the situation as of then. As far as I could see, the whole setup was like a Picasso painting. No matter how you looked at it, it was cockeyed. and upside down.
Hello, Harry. Do not order anything for me. I have not the time.
Don't worry, Lily. I'm not here to celebrate. We can have our party after I know who's going to pay the check.
Oh, you should call me Lulu.
Okay, Lulu. Now, here's all the sense I can make out of this little caper. You came here with the Corelli gang, right?
No. They came first. Then they sent for me to work in the flower shop for a front. The tunnel was their idea.
Then you sent for me. That was your idea, hmm?
Right.
Fodor thinks he's going to divvy up with the Corellis and marry you on the proceeds.
Something like that.
Fekete thinks something like the same something. The president thinks he's going to put it over on the vice president. What about the construction crew?
You mean Walter and the others?
Yes, the Corellis, the original burglars. What are they going to get out of this? According to Fekete, it's going to be the old double cross, but if I know you, Fekete's in for the same gentle treatment.
Oh, Harry, why should anyone get anything out of this except...
Okay, Lily, okay. Book a couple of spaces for us in the first milk train out of Budapest, but be sure to get reservations on the bulletproof car.
If you would call me Lulu.
Time marches on. A lot of trusting Hungarian depositors line up at the bank, leave their hard-earned pengos at the impressive-looking gilt cages for what they fondly believe is safekeeping, and hurry home to have their evening plate of goulash. Closing time comes and goes. Fekete doesn't leave. He just pretends to and stays skulking in his office. Meanwhile, Fodor takes the big packages of pengos, which, as you know, is Hungarian for money, dutifully to the door of the vault. He slams the vault loudly. This being for the benefit of the janitor, who is deaf anyway and doesn't hear, and quickly stows the loot in the empty filing cabinet, which he has thoughtfully left nearby for just this purpose. He then goes home and passes a very restless night. The moon rises over the city and winks at its own reflection in the dam. A lot of good Hungarians are in their beds. The others are all in a nightclub called the Arizona, dancing a shardash. They do not come into this story, so we'll leave them dancing. Down under the street, the Corellis, those adept bank robbers, continue to dig. They are putting the finishing touches on their tunnel, and we will not listen in on them because their conversation is very vulgar indeed. In his luxurious office, Mr. Fekete sits, biting his nails, and dreaming of a long West Indian cruise with Lulu in an adjoining deck chair. As the gang in the tunnel understand it, when the clock strikes 12, they are to open the secret trap door which they have previously prepared inside the bank, a section of tiling near the vault, go to the filing cabinet and take out the money which Fodor has left there, thus eliminating the noise and inconvenience of breaking into the vault, and, first closing the loose tile after themselves, scuttle back with the loot under the street into the flower shop, out into the night and as far away from Hungary as possible. As I say, that's the way the gang in the tunnel understand it. This is also the arrangement as Mr. Fodor understands it, with a trifling difference, that he expects Lulu to stop by for him with his share of the profits. Like Mr. Fekete, he is biting his nails and dreaming of tropical cruises. And what of Lulu? Ah, what of Lulu indeed? It is Lulu's little plan to foozle everybody, Corelli, Fodor, and Fekete. She's led them all on to this point. It is the point of departure. Lulu's departure. Lulu and all those neatly wrapped packages of pangos. The trouble is, it's all just a little too much for one little girl to handle alone, so Harry Lime's been sent for. Harry is supposed to assist at the general foozling of one and all, and then, in due time, of course, he's to be foozled as well. Lulu will send Harry off to mail a postcard, and when he gets back, Lulu will have continued her travels alone, with nothing to keep her company but the loot. That, as I say, is the way Lulu understands it. The clock, high in the steeple of St. Stefano, strikes 12. This is the signal. Mr. Corelli, that celebrated expert, with his two assistants, starts toward the bank. The tunnel was not built for comfort, and the going on hands and feet is a trifle rough. There's a bit of genteel cursing, but hearts are high. At the sound of the clock, Mr. Fecherty removes the bound bundles of money from their place of safety and checks once again the bolts and fastenings which keep the loose tile in its place. In the darkness, Mr. Fecherty smiles. He is satisfied that, contrary to the Corelli's expectations, the bank end of the tunnel is firmly and irrevocably closed. Still smiling, he starts toting the money toward the side door for which he, Mr. Fecherty, is the perfectly legal possessor of a key. On the outside, Lulu, with a high-speed car, is supposed to be waiting for him. Unfortunately, however, a moment earlier, Harry Lime on the flower shop end of the tunnel has persuaded Lulu to go down for a moment and tell the boys not to try lifting that trick tile for at least a half hour. Lulu hates herself now for not having analyzed the merits of this suggestion. She has plenty of time now to think this over, because foxy old Harry in the flower shop has bolted down the trapdoor. The clock has stopped striking, of course, and Mr. Fecherty pops out of his bank, looking for all the world like a jolly Christmas shopper, with his arms loaded with bundles. There is a high-speed car waiting for Mr. Fecherty, all right, but it is full of strange gentlemen, and they are all dressed in uniforms.
Put up your hands, Fecherty. Put up your hands. You're under arrest.
But there's some mistake.
Oh, not at all, old man. No mistake at all. You see, gentlemen, just as you were told, there he is, and there's the money.
Come along now, Fecherty. We're taking you in.
You, Harry? A police informer?
Not a bit of it, old man. I wouldn't dream of telling on you. No, the cops got the tip-off from an anonymous letter. And you know how you spell anonymous? L-U-L-U.
Lulu? She did it? Lulu?
That wouldn't be Lulu Hearts, would it? Alias Lily the Twister?
Yes, officer, I believe so. There's a reward offered for her capture, isn't there?
I should say that there is.
And what about the Corelli gang?
They've got the biggest price on their heads in Central Europe.
Oh, that's lovely. It's all beginning to add up when you throw in the generous reward Mr. Fecherty posted in the name of his bank this afternoon.
But you're not going to collect that, are you?
Why not, old man? After all, you put up the money for me to collect before the bank was robbed, didn't you? You also wanted me to thwart the Corellis. And if you yourself are foolish enough to go breaking the law, you'll just have to tell it to the judge.
I'll tell him plenty. I'll tell him about you!
Go ahead. I haven't broken any laws, remember? And you'll only help me collect my various rewards.
Matter of fact, Lime, just what is your connection with this affair? What have you done?
Officer, all I did was turn a bolt on a trapdoor. Nothing at all, really. Just a twist of the wrist. And now, if you've got some spare handcuffs ready, I think we'd better open it up again. The folks down below may be getting a little fretful, and I think they'll appreciate a change of scene. If you'll come with me, officer, I'll show you the place.
Really, Mr. Lime, I can't tell you how grateful we are.
Oh, please, please, old man, don't mention it. Pleasure, I assure you. Won't you have a cigar?
Harry Lime returns in just a moment.
Here is an important announcement.
Ladies, what's your complexion problem?
My skin's so dingy.
Mine's oily.
Mine's so dull. Coarse looking.
For a lovelier complexion, you must stop improper cleansing. Instead, use Palmolive soap the way doctors advise. Leading skin specialists have now proved the Palmolive plan using nothing but Palmolive soap can bring fresher, brighter complexions. Yes, regardless of age, type of skin, or previous beauty care. Now here's what these doctors advise.
Wash your face with Palmolive soap, massaging for 1 minute with Palmolive's soft, lovely lather. This cleansing massage brings your skin Palmolive soap's full beautifying effect. Rinse. Do this 3 times a day for 14 days.
It's that simple. But remember, 36 doctors, leading skin specialists, advise this way for 1,285 women with all types of skin. Dry, oily, normal, young, older. And prove this plan, using palm olive alone, nothing else, really works for 2 out of 3. So, for a lovelier complexion, forget all other beauty care. Instead, do as these doctors advise. Use palm olive for a fresher, brighter complexion.
For loveliness all over, use big, thrifty, bath-sized palm olive in your tub or shower.
You know, friends, I had thought of substituting those fat packages of Pangos for the same weight of old newspapers, but the rate of exchange wasn't so good on the Pango just then, so I resisted the temptation. After all, as my mother always said, too many cooks spoil the goulash.
You have been listening to Too Many Crooks, an episode in the lives of Harry Lime. Tonight's program starred Edward French as Orson Welles in the role of Harry Lime. Fecady was played by Phil Proctor. Lulu and Miss Carver were played by Melinda Peterson. The police captain was played by my fellow announcer, David Osman. Fecady's receptionist was Camden Singer, who also sang the jingle together with Phil Proctor. Tonight's program was produced and directed by Greg Oppenheimer. And this is Ivan Curry speaking for Online Radio Theater. Good night.